would like to start with this vulgus knee TKR follow-up with the 5-year results. For the our study, we use the Ranaut classification, where type 1 is a mechanical axis deviation less than 10 degree and passively correctable, and MCL is intact. In type 2, range of axis deviation 10 to 20 degrees, deformity is correctable, and medial stabilizers are lax, but they are intact. And type 3, axis deviation more than 20 degrees with non-functional medial stabilizing elements. So we use this classification, and there are a few of the cases where you see the primary osteoarthritis valgus, sometimes rheumatoid, and sometimes the patient with having the high tibial osteotomy. So the challenges in valgus is always the soft tissue balancing, hypoplastic lateral femoral condyle, tibial bone loss, and malaligned patella. So this was our aim of the study, to find out when you do the soft tissue release, what sequence you follow and how you choose the implants. So we had a 219 knees, 120 females, 19 males, and we had a 5 rheumatoid arthritis patient, and others were osteoarthritis or post-traumatic osteoarthritis. So in type 1 deformity of Ranaut classification, we had 143 patients. Type 2, we had 67 patients. And type 3, we had 9 patients. So we use in our surgical technique, we use a combined spinal epidural anesthesia. We use tunica in all the cases. We use a midline longitudinal skin incision and use a medial parapatellar arthrotomy. So lateral retinaculum and iliotibial band release from the anterolateral aspect of tibia in flexion. Before we do that, before we start the surgery, we used to see the correction of the deformity under the anesthesia. That is a very important point. And then we add this release adequacy, we assess the ability to internally rotate the tibial tuberosity beyond the midline. If you get this, then we'll go ahead with the further steps. Then pie crusting of the lateral structure in case of the residual valgus in extension. So the implants used in type 1 deformity patients, they were all posterior stabilized. In type 2 deformity, few of the patients we used the posterior stabilized, few of the patients we went ahead with the CCK, where we needed to do the more release. So, and type 3, we do the CCK. We use a modified hospital specialist score, knee scoring system. And I will show you the few of the X-rays. Type 1 with the 58-year-old male who had a valgus deformity pre and post-op. This is bilateral valgus, type 1. We had a 64-year-old with the bilateral valgus pre and post-op. Again, type 1 patient. The 68-year-old with the valgus, type 1 deformity. Then type 2 deformity, where you, on the right side, you can see the valgus deformity is more than, less than 20 degree, more than 10 degrees. So we use the same PS knee. This is one more case with the rheumatoid arthritis, where patient had a bilateral rheumatoid arthritis. Type 2 patient, we started releasing, and then we realized that we are having the flexion deformity also. So we landed up in using the CCK knee. This is a type 3 deformity where you have to use a CCK knee. I use a ligament balancer for these cases and found it very useful to give the exact femoral rotation according to the patient's native knee. And there are the few of the ligament balancers of the different system like Matthes, Smith & Nephew, then Stryker, and Zimmer. So in our post-operative regimen, 10 degree flexion, 10 degree of the flexion for the post-operative lead for 2 days. Range of movement exercises we allowed from the 10 degree to the 85 degrees from the from the day of the surgery. Weight bearing started as per the pain tolerance, and the mean hospital stay for these patients were 8 days. So our result shows the follow-up was from the 1 year to 5 years. Mean hospital score was rose from the 48 to 91 points. Mean tibiofemoral alignment improved from the 20 degrees valgus to 5 degrees valgus. Mean range of movement rose from 70 to 110, and no progressive radial lucency noted on the post-op X-rays. We had a superficial wound complication in one knee after the 3 years, treated with the antibiotics, then transient peroneal palsy, which was recovered after the conservative means, and we had symptomatic DVT in one patient. So Whiteside has clearly mentioned, you start with the sequential release, but when you do the sequential release, goes to the popliteus, you've seen that these patients, if you go ahead with the PS knees, they have a late onset instability. Healy has also mentioned that the medial collateral ligament advancement and the constant implant, if you compare those, constant implant does the same job instead of having the non-union at the advancement site. Elsley again mentioned the same thing, constant implant perform equally well when compared to the extensive lateral release and potential complication of the peroneal nerve palsy. So inside out soft tissue release of postorbital capsule with pike crusting of iliotibial band resulted in a good balancing soft tissue and excellent long-term results. So in my conclusion, sequential soft tissue release should be followed in the sequential manner for this valgus knee. Postrolateral structure first release in the flexion and then go in extension, see requirement and then you release again. And constant implants may need to be considered in lax medial structures. So the choice of implant depends on the severity of the valgus deformity, extent of the soft tissue release needed to obtain a stable knee and equal flexion extension gap in order to achieve a minimum constraint with a maximum stability. Thank you.
Any question?
Are you use that technique as well?